Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Heartwood, Southwest Virginia's Artisan Gateway. And my name is Jack Kimchel Wood. I'm the executive director of the Crooked Road, Virginia's Heritage Music Trail. And we're going to have some music here tonight. I don't know if you knew that or not, but just here shortly. I hope everyone knows that this is not the only concert during the homecoming that you can take in. We've got, I think, enough guides here if you don't have one. This is, tells you every event over 25 concerts over 9 days and 136 cultural events. So they're all here in the guide. And the website has a great searchable schedule, so you can really zero in on a certain day or a certain town or whatever you want to find what you'd like to do. A couple things going on that we're very excited about, Crooked Road-wise. This, I encourage you not to leave here tonight without our new 2016 live recordings CD from the Mountains Music Homecoming. Every year we record every minute of these incredible artists, and we boil it down to about 1 hour of the best music from the homecoming. And second of all, this supports our traditional music education program, all the proceeds from this, and we help kids after school programs learn to play this wonderful heritage music. The other thing that's pretty cool, we are hopefully in 2018, we'll have people rolling down the highways with a State of Virginia Crooked Road license plate. So, we have information about how you can do that. It's a long process, and all the information is out here on the table about that. Let's see. Oh, how many of you have seen any of the wonderful John Deere videos about the Crooked Road? Not a whole lot. Well, you ought to check this out. John Deere has a flagship magazine called The Furrow. They came here for about a week and traveled the Crooked Road, and they did a video series. They had a film crew from Los Angeles came for two trips, and they filmed all up down the Crooked Road, and they've released three of the five episodes. And today is, what's the date? 13th. 3 days from now, on the 16th, they're going to release episode 4. So it's on YouTube, just John Deere Crooked Road, and they're really excellent. They give such a flavor of this region, so you might enjoy those. Thank goodness for the incredible support that we get from a lot of quarters to help this homecoming be possible. The Virginia Tobacco Commission, Department of Housing and Community Development, and if we have anybody, we have a rep here from the Tobacco Commission. As I call these out, if somebody's come in and I didn't realize it, please stand up and be recognized. Just stay standing, and we'll give everybody standing at the end a nice round of applause. I know we've got Housing and Community Development. Mr. Todd? Okay. Food City, Appalachian Regional Commission, National Endowment for the Arts, Virginia Tourism Corporation. Remain standing, sir. Remain standing. Blue Ridge Beverage, Bluegrass Today, Oxford American, Virginia Living, Classic Country, WBRF 98.1, the Virginia Commission for the Arts, Roanoke Times, the Blue Ridge Outdoors, WCYB, Bristol Herald Courier, Southwest Virginia, Market Connections, WDBJ7, Davenport and Company. Now here's some folks right here close. Dominion, WEHC, what'd you get time to stand up, Randy? I thought you had more stamina than that. What? All right, I'm gonna let you sit down for a minute. The Loafer, WEHC, the Martha here in town, great to have them as a sponsor this year. CGI, our buddy Kirk Lawrence over there. New People's Bank, got some folks from the band maybe tonight. Guest services, they are the folks that you see here in this building that help you with food and everything that makes this a hospitable place to come. Our friends in the Abingdon Rotary Club, the Bank of Marion Hickok Fern and Company, and Walt and Janet Krickmer. Don't know if they were able to make it tonight. Are they here? They're from right here, and I appreciated them so much stepping up to help us. Well, you all are in for quite a treat. Thanks. Yes. I first heard these artists at the Smithsonian Folklife Festival a bunch of years ago, and I could not believe that much music could come out of just two people. And we're going to talk to them here just for a minute, give you a sense of who they are and where they've come from in their musical journey. So if you would, make really strong, wonderful, warm welcome for Alasdair Fraser and Natalie Haas. We had a great conversation on a bus ride over to the Smithsonian, to the mall one day, and I was very sort of fascinated to know that what you were up to before you got into fiddling full time. Can you share that?
I don't know if I want to talk about it.
The thing that we talked about this year.
No, it's, life is crazy, you know. First of all, it's just so amazing to land in this beautiful spot. Like an oasis to come, and we're thrilled and honored to be here. And to meet Jack, and Jack and I, we could spend many hours chatting about important things, music and the arts, and that's actually, as you'll probably get a sense of tonight, I had a previous life as an engineer, and growing up in Scotland, you know, you get that good advice. People would say, well, you get a good degree and use your brain and get a job as an engineer, which is great advice. But the young Alasdair wanted to play music, and I wanted to play music everywhere I went. So eventually I reached escape velocity. And I gave up my job as a petroleum engineer when I realized that I didn't really care about oil very much. And even more importantly, as I was sitting in my office one night, I used to write tunes to the sound of a mechanical plotter mapping machine that made these random rhythmic sounds, and I would write tunes to it. But then I sat back in my chair one night, and I luckily had this idea that there's no one on this planet who cannot be affected by music. And what a moment that was, and I call it like a clunk moment, a penny drop moment in my life, when I realized that music was something I don't stick onto my life. It was actually fundamental and core to it. So I've been lucky enough to do that, and I really mean that. It's a privilege to play music, and I haven't stopped since.
We're all the better for it. Tell me about where exactly in Scotland, you know, your home is, and where you grew up.
Well, I grew up in the middle, I like to say, and my father's from the Highlands, my mother's from the West Coast, the Glasgow area, and I grew up in Stirling, home of Stirling Castle and Braveheart, and all of that. It's quite funny actually, because what's his name, William Wallace, Braveheart actor, a wee guy. William Wallace was a big man, a big Scottish hero, physically tall, and Mel Gibson is not. And we laugh in Scotland, in Stirling, where I grew up, because Mel Gibson, who had a good conceit of himself, as we like to say, had a statue erected in his honor right next to Wallace's monument, and the statue of William Wallace. And it just didn't make sense. So it's not there anymore. You're on fine. But that's where I went to school, and it was near Stirling Castle.
Natalie, tell us, we had a good radio on Radio Bristol today, had a wonderful interview, and how about, you know, your roots and how you all met. I think that the folks that might not have heard that on the radio today would find that pretty interesting.
Yeah, well, I am not Scottish, as you can probably tell. I grew up in California, and luckily enough for me, Alasdair had been living there for a few years and had started a fiddle camp out there called the Valley of the Moon Scottish Fiddle School. And my sister, who's an amazing Appalachian fiddler, actually, and I went there as kids, and not really knowing anything about fiddle music. My sister had taken a couple of bluegrass lessons, but we were both doing Suzuki classical violin and cello. And we went to the camp, and I discovered this amazing universe of Scottish music and the community surrounding it. And for my sister, it was old-time music. Alasdair always invites a couple other musical cultures to come and share a little bit of their traditions with people at the camp. So that's how we both kind of got into doing what we're doing today and making music our lives. Alasdair was a great mentor to me, and we've been playing together since I was maybe 15 years old. It's been 18 years now.
Well, when we were sitting there listening, listening to you all today, it came back to me why I was so thrilled to have the chance to bring you down here, because I kind of went, as you will probably tonight, go through sheer joy to, I almost got a little weepy at some of the slow stuff that you all played today, and that's a mark of great artistry. So welcome, Alasdair Fraser and Natalie Haas, to Heartwood. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thanks to Jack for being such a wonderful host and, you know, for giving us a great welcome here. It is a privilege, as I said earlier on, to play music. It's a privilege to follow the fiddle. And as the more the years go by, I realize that that's what I've been doing all these years. The fiddle is an amazing instrument. It's great to come to a part of the world that speaks fluent fiddle. I feel I'm among kindred spirits here. And the fiddle, is, well, people see our wee band, our small ensemble, and they think, oh, that's novel. Well, that's interesting. They've lost half of their string quartet. Or they think, where's the guitar player? Or where's the piano? And we take great delight in pointing out that this is it. This was the dance band of choice in Scotland for centuries. A fiddle and a cello, fiddle and the bowed bass, all the big gatherings in Glasgow and Edinburgh and Dundee and Aberdeen, the fancy balls, the after dance sessions, the drawing room sessions, the fiddle and the cello in the golden age of the Scottish fiddle. You can look back and you can see paintings of people at events in Perthshire, up in the middle of Scotland, in the Perthshire Highlands. And you see the dancers louping around with kilts on. And then you look a bit closer and you see the musicians. And it's almost always, and they're always painted into the corner, the musicians in the corner of the painting. But there they are, the fiddler and the cello player. And the likes of Neil Gow, who was the doyen of Scottish fiddlers, who was a bit of a character and held court there for many, many years, and then his family took over from him. And he used to play with his brother Donald on the cello, and there were eyewitness accounts of people having to leave the ballroom because they couldn't contain themselves from the excitement that they were generating with the fiddle and the cello. And so Natalie and I have been having a wonderful time going back to that old well and drinking from it, but also saying, what now? Because it's near the 18th century anymore. And that's kind of the nature of our journey. And as we do follow the fiddle, whether it's the wee one or the big one, fiddle grande, it is amazing. You travel, and the fiddle, if you just pause for a wee minute with the fiddle in your hand and you give it its head like a horse, and you follow it, it takes you to beautiful areas and sacred areas and healing places and wild places where people do things they never thought they would do that night. Wee innocent thing that it is gets itself into trouble a lot, as you well know, I'm sure. And the minister famously on the Isle of Skye in Scotland in the 19th century burned all the fiddles because they were creating too many great acts of promiscuity. So that's what we're dealing with here. But the fiddle and cello belong together, they've evolved together. And we began there, as we most often do, with a Scottish tune. Actually, it's a beautiful song, some of you may have recognized. It's called The Freedom Come O' Ye. And it expresses something that is very innate in the Scottish condition, which is this idea of we have to take care of our neighbors. We have to reach hands across the world, across the planet, across the counties, across countries, and we take care of each other. And it was written by Hamish Henderson, great folklorist, ethnomusicologist. And he wrote that, and it's very much a part of, as I say, the Scottish condition. Robert Burns, going back to the 18th century again, wrote one of his great poems, A Man's a Man for All That. And it's, again, it's about taking care of each other and looking after each other and making the world a better place. It almost seems controversial to talk about these things in this day and age. But when you follow the fiddle, it turns over so many stones. You talk about everything, you confront everything. And it's such an honor to do that. So that was The Freedom Come O' Ye. And then after that, we went to the world of Natalie.
The second tune, the jig, is one that I wrote. And I'll tell you the name in a second, but first I'll tell you the story of how I came at the name. We have a new CD out as of a couple months ago. It's called Ports of Call. And I'll tell you more about that title in a second. But as we were sort of gathering material for this album, this was about a year and a half ago, We were in Chicago, we had a couple days off, and we were having a little writing session, and I brought this tune, that melody, to the table. I had already written it, and we were working up an arrangement for it, and I had just been to the farmer's market and had bought one of my favorite snack foods, which is English peas, you know, the kind that come in the pod, where you don't eat the pod. So I was trying my very best to eat these peas as we were working on this arrangement, and playing the cello and eating peas at the same time is easier said than done. So most of them went in my mouth, but then occasionally one would miss and just sort of dribble down the front of the cello. And then eventually one ended up in this perfect pea-sized hole. These are known as the F-holes, if you didn't already know that. So I feel like I really didn't have another choice but to call the tune Pea in the F-hole. Now you understand why I have to tell you the story before I told you the name. Alasdair is quite scandalized that I would put a tune of that name after this gorgeous, epic Scottish anthem. But it's my tune, so I get to name it. So as I said, we decided to call the new CD Ports of Call, and the reason for that is we both have kind of grown up with Scottish music in very different contexts, obviously, but we also get to travel the world and are very lucky and blessed to do that and to encounter other cultures and get to sort of have these shared musical conversations with them. And so through these travels and through the fiddle camps, which we'll tell you more about later, which are really just sort of excuses to have these amazing cultural exchanges, we've really gotten to encounter the music of many other cultures, all of whom share a very deep love of the fiddle and of the dance. So we're going to explore a few of these neighboring countries tonight, and we're going to start off by taking you down to France for a couple of dance tunes. The first two are, they're all modern tunes actually, so written within our lifetimes. The first two would be Dance to a Scottish. First one's called Derrière les Carreaux, which means behind the window panes, which we all are right now. and then the second one is called Mominette, which it refers to a little apéritif drink, very similar to absinthe, got some anise flavor in it. And then the last tune takes us up to Brittany, to the Celtic part of France, up in the northwest corner, and was written by a wonderful Celtic fingerstyle guitar player called Soig Sibiril. And it is called The Road to Carrigwark. That's the English translation. It also has a Breton name. So here we go to France. Thank you.
Well, since we're wandering around following the fiddle, and we find ourselves in France, let's go a little bit further south and take a right turn, and we might, well, find ourselves on the great pilgrimage trail, the Camino de Santiago. Has anyone hiked the trail? It's an amazing trail, and it's an amazing part of the world. We go to Galicia, and sure enough, we find in Galicia a fun-loving, high-energy, stay-up-all-night party people who love to play the fiddle. And at this point, I kind of like to mention that it wasn't always that way, and when you do follow the fiddle, you find, very often, you find it's a great litmus test for the cultural health of the region that you're visiting. And sure enough, in Spain, in Galicia, for many, many, many years, people were scared to play their fiddles because they had been banned from playing the fiddle. They had incredible damage done by Franco, the dictator, who not only banned the fiddle, but banned certain ways of speaking, banned certain dialects, certain songs. And as it was always the case, people have to struggle for their voice. And we had to do the same in Scotland. You had to struggle for our voice. And you find this often. I'm sure some of you will know exactly what I'm talking about here. It is a struggle to find the voice and to be allowed to speak in your native tongue. And so the Galicians, as in many parts of Spain, had to do that. But these days, they're doing very well, and there are hordes and hordes of fiddlers now in Galicia. And that's one of the reasons that we started these fiddle camps that Natalie mentioned. We met at a fiddle camp which I started 33 years ago. And then I went back home to Scotland and started fanning the flames of inquiry on the Isle of Skye about why were the Scots not playing their own tunes? Why were people embarrassed about speaking in a Scottish accent? Why was it when I grew up in Scotland, I could not hear the news being read on the BBC in a Scottish accent? It wasn't allowed. You had to speak in received pronunciation, which meant speak properly. And I learned, took me a few years, but I learned that if ever I hear the word proper, I head for the door. And nowadays, Scotland we've found some freedom in that respect. We're now speaking confidently in our own accents again. The bagpipers have taken their grace notes back from the military. It used to be that if you played the pipes and you played in a pipe band, you had to play the military grace notes. The British have a lot to answer for. So the Scots took the grace notes back. We were told not to educate our children Gaelic, to have them speak Gaelic, because it was a language of poverty and they would never get work. And so again, the British Empire at its worst. But we confronted that. And so 30 years further on, we got our Gaelic is on the rise again. We've got kids playing fiddles and bagpipes and making up tunes and dances. And even a couple of years ago, we almost took control of our country back. So we followed the fiddle and it leads you into many areas. And then we did the same in Spain with the Galicians and the Asturians and the Basque and the Catalonian and the Castellano. And we realized that whenever you have trouble like that, whenever someone is trying to suppress your voice, what you do is you start a fiddle camp. So we did that in Spain 10 years ago. We have the 10th celebration this year. And we gather in Spain, north of Madrid, and we rock the Scottish condition up against the Spanish condition. And we generate a lot of heat. And we play into the wee hours, and it's cathartic. People are in tears as they once again realize it was okay all along for them to sing their song. And then last year we started a fiddle camp in Australia, and we brought in the Aboriginal people, and we had Aboriginal songs and dances, and Australians learning them and having a meal at the table for the first time ever with an Aboriginal person in Australia. So that was a lot of tears, and so it was amazing to follow that. So having said all that, that's, I think, part of the joy you hear in this next medley is that sense of celebrate life, speak in your own voice, and have confidence in your own voice. As we go to Galicia, and we play a set of Muñeras, which in Scotland we would call jigs.
you. So you heard some very joyful music there from Galicia, and we're gonna take you a little further north this time, and still visiting the neighbors. We'll make it back to Scotland eventually. But so we're gonna make a little stopover in Scandinavia, where they see a lot less sunlight, and it's definitely reflected in their music. So this is a beautiful old tune. It's a type of dance called a polska from Finland, and it's called the Himlen's polska, which means the devil's polska. And then we'll make our way over to Norway for a waltz called Carl Font's Waltz. And we played in Norway last year for the first time at this wonderful little folk festival in a small town called Røros, which is about halfway up and very close to the Swedish border. And we discovered when we played this tune for them that we'd been playing for a while and thinking that it was from Sweden, but we were definitely put in our place by these Norwegian fiddle players who informed us that Carl Font actually was from this town. So they got to claim the origins of this tune. And we also learned that Font is their word for gypsy. So Carl Font was a gypsy, and he is the guy, he spent a few years of his life in Røros. We got to go visit his house. He spent a few years of his life there with his family, and he is also the guy who gets credited with bringing the waltz to Norway. So from it, wherever else he was in Europe, he must have encountered that and became hugely popular after that. So Finland and Norway, here we go.
Thank you.
we'll go back, for me anyway, to the homeland, back to the core, and play an old Scottish strathspey. And here we are talking about travelling, not the travelling that musicians do, but the amazing thing is that these tunes travel. Man, can they tell some stories. Some of these old tunes, they have been around, and they've shown themselves to be extremely resilient. Generation after generation seizes a hold of these tunes and they give them a good shake and they make them relevant yet again. So we're gonna take one tune now and just kind of zoom in on it a wee bit and find out where it's been. And it's an epic Scottish strathspey going back to the 18th century, and it's called The Highlander's Farewell to Ireland. And it, right there, it raises a question. What were they doing in Ireland? And why were they leaving? And if you followed that little stream, it would take you to Canada and to Montreal and to the British and the French, and it would take you to the 78th Fraser Highlanders Regiment. All kinds of stories there, but we're not gonna follow that fork. We're gonna play the tune the old way. And Robert Burns had a great bard had a great eye and an ear and a heart for a good fiddle tune. He played the fiddle a wee bit himself. And he would write his lyrics, his poetry, to fiddle tunes that were running around in his head. And this would be one of them. He turned the Highlander's Farewell fiddle tune, the dance tune, into a song called Highland Harry. And this was in 18th century Scotland. And Highland Harry was a 18th century hit single. We were just down at the home of country music today looking at all the music and all the recording history and all that. It was absolutely wonderful. But here we are, here I am talking about a hit single in 1763, or maybe 1774. And what that meant was that Robert Burns would issue a new song, and his publisher, who was a very astute businessman, would let it be known that Robert Burns has come out with a new song, and he would issue a pamphlet, a single piece of paper, with an arrangement on it, a musical arrangement, and the words to Robert Burns' new song. And it would go on sale at Neil Gow and Sons Music Shop in Edinburgh. For example, just imagine, 1774, there's a new pamphlet down there at Neil Gow's Music Shop. People would scamper down there and they'd buy the piece of music and they'd run home and they would gather and they would play Robert Burns' new single. And so that was the Highland Harry. We'll play that. But then we're gonna follow the tune because it has a very interesting life. It shows up in Ireland to this day as a reel called The Killarney Boys of Pleasure, the same tune. So we'll nip over to Ireland and we'll play the Irish version of the same tune. And then we'll come across to this beautiful part of the world and we'll play the Appalachian version. Now I want to make sure I'm saying that right. Did I already mess up? I can see heads nodding. Appalachian. We never got out of here if I hadn't mentioned it. My tires let down outside. The Appalachian version, which is played to this day by many old-time fiddlers as the Highlander's Farewell. There it is, alive and well, began its life as a Scottish strathspey. So this basically is a medley of one tune and all its different incarnations. Only not quite, because after the Irish version, we stick in a wee jig that has nothing at all to do with it. We just like the jig and it kind of fits in well. You can regard it as sort of a palate cleanser. Before we go to the Appalachian version. And right at the very end, you'll hear the Appalachian version having a great time zooming along there. And in parallel with that, you hear the original Scottish version, the old strathspey, swimming alongside as they kind of wink at each other and flirt across the ocean and across the centuries as they're once again reunited. So the journey of the Highlanders, farewell, and then we'll take a wee break.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. One more time for Mr. Fraser and Natalie Haas.
A song that we played on the radio earlier today. It's one of my compositions, which is on a new CD, and it's called the Waltzka for Sua, and I'll tell you what that means. Sua Lee is a wonderful cellist, classical cellist. She plays with the Scottish Chamber Orchestra, and a couple years ago she had a 6-month sabbatical from her orchestra job, and she decided that she wanted to spend it by coming to fiddle camp, which is very unusual for an orchestral musician, I think. So she did. She spent a couple of months over in the States, came to our Valley of the Moon camp, and did a couple others as well. And at the end of her time here, she wrote to me. I didn't know her too well at the time, and asked if she could come and study with me intensively for 2 weeks in Montreal, where I used to live. She really wanted to delve deeply into the Celtic cello world. So I was a little daunted at this suggestion, because I knew not only was she an amazing musician, but also she asked me not just if she could study with me, but if she could live with me for 2 weeks. And I didn't really know what to say to that, but I said to myself, well, she's a cellist. She can't be that bad. So I said yes, and she came, and we had a fantastic time. We hit it off from day one. And I wrote this tune while she was there and decided to dedicate it to her to commemorate our time together. And I called it a waltzka because, as to my knowledge anyway, this type of tune didn't previously exist. The A part is a waltz, and the B part is kind of a wannabe polska. It's got a couple beats missing. But this is the waltzka for Sua. Thank you. So you will have gathered by now that it's part of the tradition to make up new tunes, and often they end up getting named for people close to us or occasions. So we're gonna play another tune that I wrote now. This is Megan and Jared's Waltz, which I wrote for my best friend's wedding a couple of years ago. And then we'll go back to Scotland for a great new jig written by another fiddle player, composer by the name of Mike Vass, and it's called The Cavers of Kirkwood, a very popular session tune these days. Thank you.
you know, it's we're never that far away from just suggesting that we clear the chairs and have a dance. It's that close all the time, and it has happened many times. In fact, we take it further than that. We have a dance, and then we end up stopping traffic in the street outside and all kinds of things. But the dance is so important, and we're going to nip back up to Scandinavia now for a medley that will begin with a bridal march. Why not? A bridal march from Norway. And then since we're in Norway, we'll nip over to Sweden for a quick polska, as one does. And then we'll come back to Norway for a very important dance form and tune that the Norwegians are very proud of. It's called a halling. And we actually got to see the halling being danced and played when we were in Røros last year. And it's a pretty high energy, intense dance that usually at its climax involves a male dancer on the dance floor working himself into an incredible rotational state of excitement, whirling round dervish-like until he gets so much rotational momentum going that he can leap up into the air and kick the hat off of a 10-foot pole. They have long winters in Norway. So, not only does he have to kick the hat off, but then he has to keep going and gracefully get back down on the floor and continue in the dance. So we saw that, and we're going to play that now. And if anyone wants to have a go at it, we'll do it in the lobby afterward. So a bridal march, and then a polska, and then just imagine these Norwegians getting excited.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. We're going to play one more, and I think we're going to go right back to Scotland. And if we were at a wee ceilidh or something, very often someone might sing a song and people would join in, whether they knew it or not. They'd find themselves just humming along. And the great thing about some of the old Gaelic airs songs is that they've got built-in addiction. They're very short. They don't have a lot of notes, but they go very deep. And so just for this final moment here, by way of thanks to Jack and to all of you for coming out tonight, let's go to that place now. And we're going to play this old Gaelic song and pretend that we're somewhere in the Isle of Skye or something. And then Natalie and I are going to work ourselves into some kind of highly elevated state of ethnic excitement. And we'll see where that takes us. So are you game?
Yeah.
Let's go to that Gaelic place.
Thank you.
Thank you.